Hi, everybody, and welcome to Dystopian Simulation Radio. I'm your host, Chris.
And I'm Linz.
And how are you doing today, Linz?
Yeah, good. I think we explained in the previous episode that we are doing a bit of a marathon recording.
We are. It has been a whole 3 minutes since I spoke to you.
Yeah, a quick two-minute bathroom break, and here we are.
And a sip of the old water.
Sip of the old water. Get those kidneys going.
Well, I tell you what, let's just get straight into it. As always, we want to thank our Patreons and everything that they do to us. We are recording these in batch, so if anybody has joined between the 29th of June when we're recording these and when this comes out, we do apologise. You will be in the next one that we record. But of course, let's do this. Thank you very much to Patrice, Polk Daddy, Ordained Sinister Minister, Devon Sweatshirt, Graves, Heather Wynn, Riff Cult, Cropley Crab, Cash Brush, Creepy Paper, Jamie Suck, Michael Laughlin, Lindsay Keller, Mike Wright, Greer Reether, Kelsey Carruthers, Linz Gibson, Drake Halvig, Only Child, Michael M., Wesley Akers, Riaz K., Emily Medeiros, Pip, and Philip.
Thanks, guys. We appreciate you as always.
Yes, you do. You do keep the podcast going. You know the drill. You can follow us over on Instagram at
d.s.radio.
That's public. Anyone can do that there. But if you want to step it up to the next level and become a Patreon, you can do that over at
patreon.com/dystopian simulation radio. Come join the chat.
You can
watch Chris puke at the idea of French fries and milkshake, which he might be trying later if there is a milkshake in the vicinity.
Is there?
They may be.
Oh, okay. I mean, if they just...
Yeah. Let's not start, Chris. You're going to try it and it'll be on the Patreon.
The two things are fine. They just should never mix.
Racist.
Speaking of racists, I have an important announcement to make.
No, don't.
Hulk Hogan has his own beer.
Oh.
Real American beer. It's only available in the States currently, but...
Someone needs to send it to us.
Anyone wants to send a case of that over... I'll drink it.
We could both drink it and then do like a Hulk Hogan related taste test and another episode on Hulk. Oh no. I mean.
Skin of a hot dog.
I thought you said skin of his hot dog. And I was like, let's skip the taste test.
Well, as we learned about a Hulk Hogan episode, Hulk Hogan and Terry Bollea have very different size penis lengths. Despite being the same person.
How did we get here? How did we get here? Right. Images that go along with this episode, d.s.radio, images of Hulk Hogan's penis, probably elsewhere on the internet.
Everywhere. Okay, then. So let's jump into today's episode, Linz, and I'm excited to tell this story to you. Linz, today, or this evening even, we're going to be talking about an individual who was really summed up in the suffix that accompanies his name. Or should I say prefix, because it's not a suffix, because it comes before his name. I'll let it speak to itself. Today's file is on your friend and mine, Mad Jack Churchill. You ever heard of him?
Jack Churchill?
Jack Churchill.
No.
Well... You're about to. Jack Churchill, no relation to Winston.
Oh, okay.
Or the insurance dog, was the ultimate Brit. So, naturally, he was born in modern-day Sri Lanka. Of course, that was British territory at the time. And that time was the 16th of September, 1906. In his early life, his family bounced between Sri Lanka, Blighty, Hong Kong, and then good old Blighty again. Jack's father served in multiple high-ranking roles within the Commonwealth, accounting for the vigorous movement around the world of the family. Now, being British and the son of a notable civil servant of the British Empire, his name was not just Jack Churchill. No, 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 no. His full name was John Malcolm Thorpe Fleming Churchill, or Jack for short.
Thank God he had a nickname.
I know, I couldn't read that every single time. Also, it, I don't know.
Although we can talk. Our names are like addresses.
I never really think of Jack being short for John, but it is.
Is that what... I thought it was just a name on its own.
Well, it's not short because it's the same amount of letters, but it's a nickname for John. But it can be a name in itself in the modern day. I suppose it's short for Jonathan.
No one's name is actually their name. That's what I've discovered recently. Paul McCartney shocked me.
No. Well, he's not even Paul McCartney. But Jack is competing with me for the most middle names there.
Yes.
So Jack set his sights on becoming a military man. And after his formal education on the Isle of Wight, he attended Sandhurst for his military training. For those not in the know, Sandhurst is the oldest and most respected military college in the United Kingdom, if you're into that sort of thing.
If you're into that sort of thing, you know, that being in the military.
Jack spent his days honing his skills in several disciplines, including archery, in which he excelled. But he also was not the greatest student and studied the wrong campaign for his exams and found himself unable to pass the tests and achieve higher rankings in the military.
Oh, no.
As a result. Following his graduation from Sandhurst in 1962, there was, for Jack, a distinct lack of war in the nearby vicinity. So he was commissioned into the Manchester Regiment and packed his bags for Burma, modern-day Myanmar, in which he got his first taste of military life during the Burma Rebellion. Now, during his time there, Jack fell under the tutelage of the pipe major of the Cameron Highlighters.
The pipe major.
Now, that isn't a Scottish Super Mario lens. I know, I was surprised too. But this is actually the head bagpiper. And naturally, while he was there, Mad Jack took up and mastered the bagpipes.
You know what? I'm kind of jealous.
Well, following the completion of the campaign in Burma, Jack rode a motorbike 1,500 miles across the Indian subcontinent and only crashed into one water buffalo.
Pretty good going.
He returned to England, but this era of peace following the Great War was a bit of a drag. So Jack quit the army in 1936. And put together the most eclectic mix of jobs on a resume known to man in a mere 3.5 years before World War II kicked off.
I know how that feels.
Firstly, he became a newspaper editor in Nairobi, Kenya, or Kenya, as he would have said. And then he worked on the side while he was there as a male model.
Oh, was he hot?
You're going to see in a second.
Oh, Mad Jack.
He was maybe 1930s hot.
My favourite kind of hot.
He also picked up a showbiz career and appeared in the 1938 film A Yank at Oxford.
Is that the title?
I bet you can't guess the plot of that movie. And Jack also continued on with his bagpiping and placed second in the military piping competition at the Aldershot Tattoo.
Military piping competition.
Sadly, though, his rendition of Pimpin' Ain't Easy by Ice-T was not good enough to take first place.
Pipin' Ain't Easy.
Pipin' Ain't Easy, that's it. Jack also competed for Great Britain in the World Archery Competition in 1939, coming in 26th of 37, which for Mad Jack isn't all that great, to be honest, but he still beat a Frenchman who came in 27th, so that's all that mattered. Now, during Mad Jack's time outside the army, something was rumbling in the background. A man with a very silly mustache and many body doubles to his name began angrily shouting in beer halls. And then at bigger beer halls, and then in town squares, and then suddenly found himself Chancellor of Germany.
Oh.
A mysterious fire at the Reichstag later and a sprinkling of an enabling act. And you know what? That silly man with a moustache, and according to a song, only one ball, was now dictator of Germany. And on the 1st of September 1939, he had built up enough to send some tanks rumbling into Poland. The UK and France declared instant war. And having remained in service, and having remained in reserve, suddenly, Jack was back in the army. Jack said, "I was back in my red coat, the country having got itself into a bit of a jam in my absence." So, thus, Jack found himself rejoining the Manchester Regiment and finally having a chance to go to real war.
Just like he'd always wanted.
And do it his way.
Mm-hmm. Can we see Jack?
Yes, we can. So we're going to talk about Jack's method of war in a moment.
Oh, God.
Let's just shelve that and take a look at him. I do have a lovely little picture prepared of him for you here.
Ooh, all right. Yeah, I mean, it's a white guy. Got a very stern face. He's not... Could I see him doing some modelling? I guess he's a bit older in this picture. So, yeah, I can see him being a model back in the days. He looks very stern, but he also looks a little bit cheeky.
He's got a nice little sort of very faint moustache there as well.
Yeah, a little... I don't know. Don't know what to feel about him. I know he's got a mad nickname and he's a mad person. Mm. Doesn't look like it from the picture. Looks like he could be a little bit mischievous, but other than that, he looks quite kind.
I mean, well, there's nothing to say that he wasn't kind, to be honest. He seems later in life to have been a very kind man, to be honest. The mad prefix mm-hmm. comes more from his methods of warfare.
Right.
Just take a look at the gentleman again, and what do you think that his method of war might be?
I have no clue, but I feel it's something to do with a lot of scheming, a lot of strange plans, maybe one-man plans.
One-man plans, yes, but the word plan, I would say, is completely absent.
Flying by the seat of his pants.
Somewhat, yeah. Okay. If a next picture comes through, don't look at it. I'm just trying to send it in advance. Okay. So let's dive into it. But I think we need to go into a bit more of history to explain them.
Mm-hmm.
So at the outbreak of World War II, Jack was sent to France as part of the British Expeditionary Force, or the BEEF, as I call them. And they were sent into France in the earliest days of the war, which of course ended in the British retreat and the famous escape from Dunkirk. And while patrolling, Jack decided that the most effective weapon that he could use was his longbow.
This is amazing. Was he just taking people out from the shadows?
Well, just in case those bastards got too close, he also had by his side a secondary weapon, a basket-hilted Scottish broadsword.
I thought you were going to say a bagpipe. He was going for the shock offensive.
He completed this iconic look with a full set of bagpipes.
Yeah.
So, what do you think, Lynn? Would you go into war with this loadout?
Yes. I mean, do you know what, right? Guns, heavy, run out of ammunition, loud. They jam.
Yeah. The longbow is silent and deadly up to 200 feet.
Yeah, and if you want, you can go and collect your arrow from some guy's head.
Reusable.
Bagpipes. If you run out of ammo, you can...
Bludgeon a man.
Bludgeon him with a, or you could scare him by just going, brew, in the darkness. Yeah. And then that's like, you could shock him. He'd be like, what the hell is that? He's probably never heard such an amazing instrument in his life.
Fritz wouldn't have heard him.
And then, Fritz. And then just shove a sword through him, you know? Like, honestly, I don't think it's a terrible selection of weapons. Some might say it's not traditional.
It's unusual, definitely.
It's unusual, but I mean, why the devil not?
Well, why the devil not? And if you don't believe me, here's a picture of him with those bagpipes.
With those back pants. Right. Oh, God. I'm going to brace myself. Holy crap. That is really fucking cool. Yeah. So he was like marching himself into war playing his bagpipes.
Mm-hmm.
Is that like motivational? Like, you know, when... when you're going to do something that's slightly scary and you put your sort of playlist on and you're like, I can do this.
Yeah.
He's like motivating himself with his bagpipes. Like it got him going.
This was his gym workout playlist.
It got him going, didn't it? Like, obviously he was like, it gave him that confidence to go into battle. Imagine like, I'm imagining that he's quite successful with his kit and that the Germans would start to fear the sound of bagpipes in the distance of this one-man army. It's like a RoboCop of his day.
Also, if you look at that picture, is that Sean Connery to his right?
Just might be.
Fashionista wearing that polo neck.
I know, I was about to say. It's pretty hot.
About unusual choices.
Very so, Finnish.
While on patrol, the story goes that Jack's company were trapped, pinned down, and knew they had to fight their way out. Jack took out the first Nazi with his longbow and then raised his broadsword to the sky and screamed. This was a subtle hint for the rest of the company to attack. He then grabbed two machine guns and double-wielded them to fight their way out of the situation like an absolute, well, madman. When he ran out of ammunition, he led the remainder of his company past the enemy under the cloak of darkness, despite having been shot. The longbow kill in this story is disputed. Supposedly, Jack later claimed in life that it was his plan to take his first Nazi by longbow, but the bow had been crushed by a lorry earlier in the campaign. But regardless, he's still a pretty badass motherfucker. It has been suggested by Vice Media that this is actually true, and it is in fact the last wartime kill by a longbow in history.
Hell yeah.
Even in retreat, Jack seemed to storm through France like a main character in a video game, ensuring maximum damage to the Germans and saving wounded British soldiers along the way. Jack even tried to retrieve a tank by hitching six trucks together, but ultimately failed. Still, he did pull the servicemen to safety. Upon the bitter retreat, Jack heard the news of something. Something new. A new type of soldier that was being put together. Something called a commando.
Yes.
It was being trained to see heavy action, Jack said. I've got no idea what that is, but sign me up. So, he was sent to Scotland for training. And of note, this is where he met his wife, Rosamond, marrying her in 1941.
Rosamond?
Rosamond, like Rosamund.
Oh, Rosamund.
Rosamond. Now, nobody knew exactly what a commando was at this time, but Jack was certainly setting the bar and the pace. He reportedly was living and breathing the training and taking other recruits under his wing. He was quickly becoming a leader, but the men also saw another side of him. On the rare occasions that the commandos were not on night drills, Jack would frequently play the bagpipes in the hotel at 3 a.m., keeping everyone else awake, but nobody dared to tell him to stop.
He could have done that to the enemy, to like deprive them of any sleep.
He could have. I mean, that would have been good in the trenches, potentially.
He really loved those bagpipes.
Oh, he loves these bagpipes.
What would, was he playing any specific song, or was it just the no, 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 no needy.
He, I think he played a whole gambit of songs.
All right.
He was also, however, during training, occasionally criticized by officers for being armed with a fucking sword.
Why not?
To which he would reply, "Any officer who goes into action without a sword is improperly dressed." Now, remember, of course, during World War One, swords were pretty common. But towards the end of the war, with the increasing use of guns and specifically machine guns, it had regulated the sword to being largely ceremonial. But take a look at this picture, Linz, and see if you can spot Jack.
Okay, so we've got a bunch of soldiers jumping off a boat that's pulling up onto the shoreline. I'm looking for a sword.
Try the bottom right.
Oh my God, yeah, he's right at the...
Of course he's right at the front.
He's right at the front with his long sword. That's amazing. But the other guns, I guess they have bayonets.
I imagine they probably do have
bayonets. They would have had bayonets, yeah. But that's no sword. You can't wield. You can do a stabby-stabby with a bayonet.
You can press F3.
But his sword, he's running into action, sword in hand. That's a long-ass sword.
Mm. Jack and the other commandos were finally deployed on their first mission, which this picture is of, in December of 1941, when they were unleashed on Nazi-occupied Norway in the town of Vasco. Churchill was in charge of two companies during this attack and took the only logical decision for Jack, which was he was to stand at the head of the lead boat that was landing and play the bagpipes as loud as he fucking could. Upon landing, he would then walk head-on into the enemy on the beach, drawing his sword and screaming warlike chants, which he did as he disappeared into the fog. The commandos actually had a little trouble taking the beach and then liberating the town, taking prisoners of around 100 Nazis and leaving the rest as corpses. They also liberated around 70 men who could go on to join the Norwegian war effort. The damage that the commandos, and specifically Jack here, caused can't be understated, because beyond the death, they also damaged supplies, supply lines, and forced the Nazis to redirect troops to Norway, and they were sorely needed on their other fronts. Fortunately for Mad Jack, he does have a slight bit of bad luck here, where he'd be temporarily taken out of action. He was celebrating the liberation with some libations of his own, a few bottles of wine, and somehow a British munitions charge went off nearby and lodged chunks of a wine bottle directly into his head.
Oh my freaking God. You know, the penchant for wine is starting to make a bit of sense with the 3 a.m. bagpiping.
Mm.
But now he's got a wine bottle to the head.
Yeah. And he had to be taken out of action for this. And not long later, he was fully recovered though.
Okay.
And he jumped straight back in with the Marines, but this time in Italy, where at the Salerno landings, he won the Distinguished Service Order for his leadership, which resulted in the capture of 136 Italian prisoners and 42 of the Nazis stationed there. He captured himself.
Holy shit! He's an absolute legend.
He did this. He went in with just his sword and one corporal. And he found himself behind enemy lines and walked. He walked around to every single sentry post and captured the Nazi stationed there.
What?
He then used the previous Nazi's voice speaking out to get close to the next sentry point, thinking that they were a friend, where he promptly would draw his sword to their throat and then add the Nazis to this sort of chain of Nazis that he had going behind him.
A conga line of prisoners.
He was congering across the Italian front. He would, of course, need to make sure that they wouldn't escape, so he made them take the bolts out of their rifles and hold heavy weaponry so they could then repurpose it later. So when he rounded them all up, he also got them to extract a German mortar cannon from behind enemy lines. Now, Churchill maintained that if you shouted anything in English loud enough at a German, they would understand it. A way of thinking that thousands of British people have employed every day since then. Next up, where on earth is Mad Jack Churchill? Well, Jack visits the Adriatic, but things don't go quite as planned. So Jack, the commandos, and about 1,000 Yugoslavians were conducting raids on boats, assassinating German officers and other such hijinks that would likely get him expelled from school if this only wasn't World War II. Eventually, the band began attacking the islands and attempting to liberate the islands in the Adriatic Sea. And the island of Brac is where Jack ran into a bit of a pickle. After capturing a vital hilltop camp, he found his crew decimated. There were only 6 men left, including Jack, 3 wounded badly, and Jack the only one armed with any weapon better than a revolver. He had an American carbine that he had somehow acquired.
A carbine?
Yeah.
What's that?
Carbine's a type of machine gun.
Okay.
A handheld machine gun, I do believe, but I am British, so I don't know that much about guns. Suddenly, mortar rounds began shelling the hilltop, and 3 of the 6 men were killed instantly, and the others were wounded, Jack being the last man standing. So he pulled the most big dick energy move he could. He whipped out his bagpipes and started playing and playing and playing until he was knocked unconscious from a grenade blast.
That was his response?
Yeah.
Okay. Very mad, Jack.
I mean, he thought he was going to die at this case, so he thought, I might as well go out playing.
So he loved those bagpipes.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he really loved those bagpipes.
So Jack was, at this point, captured by the Germans. But fortunately, he was captured by Captain Thuner, who refused to follow Hitler's direct order to kill commandos on sight, as he felt that this was unsoldierlike. As a side note to this, Jack would later repay the favour by meeting Thuner again post-war and not only thank him, but ensure that he was captured by the West and not handed over to the Russians.
Aww.
Faced a much, much worse fate. Now, interestingly, this is where Jack's name came in handy, because there was some suspicion by the Nazis that he may somehow be related to Winston Churchill, and thus could be a very valuable prisoner of war. So he was eventually transported to Berlin, but managed to set fire to the aeroplane that he was on as it landed, causing considerable damage. When he was interviewed afterwards, he blamed the army officer who was escorting him, saying that he'd simply fallen asleep with his pipe, my dear boy.
He's actually genius. He's a menace.
Jack was then sent to Sachsenhausen, which was a concentration camp, but it couldn't hold Mad Jack for very long. And he escaped through an abandoned and unguarded drain pipe. I imagine this is quite a big
what?
Drain pipe here. You know, there's nothing on record to say that he was double jointed and could sort of incy wincy spider his way along your average
Eugene Tombs
drain pipe. Exactly. I'm imagining
big pipes in Germany.
Yeah. Well, he was obviously, he did know his way around the pipes.
He knew a good pipe when he saw one.
Sadly for Jack, upon escape, he was captured almost immediately around 2 or 3 miles away from camp when he reached the coast and unfortunately also reached a passing German troop. So he was then sent to Austria to another camp where he was interned for quite some time, waiting for his opportunity to escape. That day finally came when there was a power outage to the camp's lights. He took this opportunity, he was on work duty at the time, and simply disappeared into the Alps. And never came back.
Wearing completely unprepared into the Alps.
Wait.
Okay.
No, he wasn't completely unprepared, right?
Okay.
He had quite the toolkit with him.
Okay.
He had a small empty tin can.
Uh-huh.
And a string of onions.
I mean, both useful things, but probably not.
So he therefore posed as a Frenchman.
Probably wouldn't have helped.
No. What he actually did is way more impressive. So it was a long and hard walk through the Alps, having only the aforementioned empty tin can and a string of onions. But he did trade the onions for other foods as he walked and cooked them upon the tin can.
Oh, okay, genius. Mm. A little camping pot.
And then he finally saw a glorious sight.
Bagpipes.
Even better, baby. Uncle Sam.
Oh, ooh.
Yeah, the USA to the rescue. He came across a convoy, flagged them down, and convinced them that he was indeed a British commando, upon which they took him to the nearest British station, where he was to be given 17 cups of tea, a signed tea towel by the king, and 4 whole custard creams.
Are you joking? This is a joke, right?
Yes.
Because, like, after that journey, I think you like, should be rewarded that.
Yeah. Well, whatever meal he was given, he wolfed it down. And it was explained to him that the war in Europe was drawing to a conclusion. And for a military man like Jack, this meant the end of fun and games.
He was sad. He was like, oh, we were just getting started.
But then he remembered something. That convoy, the Yanks had told him that the Japanese had attacked Pearl Harbor. So Jack stood up, raised his sword in the air and screamed, "Send me to Burma."
Okay, he just lived for war, didn't he?
I might have dramatized that last bit. But Jack did go very quickly to Burma, but not quick enough. When he made a pit stop in India, he heard the news about the bombs being dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, effectively ending World War II. Jack was downtrodden. He believed he could have had another 10 years of fighting if it wasn't for the bombs. So he stayed out east for a while, helping and putting out small fires here and there, rebellions in the British colonies.
Did he play, like, sad bagpipe songs on rooftops and such?
Pretty much. But this was short-lived, you know, and he was looking down the barrel at 40. Jack decided to go back to school. Paratrooper school, that is. So Jack remained active and even made some further movie appearances during his rare days off using his archery skills in the movie Ivanhoe.
Oh, okay.
Before long, he was back in action, this time in Palestine. And he was involved in a number of delicate circumstances. There's a long story here, but he set a personal best and rescued 700 Jewish patients, staff and students from the university hospital when it was under attack during the fighting there. After this, Jack made the move to becoming an instructor, first moving to Australia to train troops in land air warfare, where he also took up surfing.
Oh, that's such a Mad Jack move. And then he's going to take a surfboard into every future war that he fights.
I mean, it's not on record if he also took with him a claymore when he was surfing, just in case of the odd shark attack.
But, sushi.
Yeah, of course I'm kidding. Sharks are friends. That was a joke. Jack would officially move back to England and retire from the military officially at that time, before taking up a job in the civil service, overseeing the training of young cadets. Stories go that he would often bemuse passengers on the train during his commute home as he would toss his briefcase from the window. Whoa. What they didn't realise was that he was actually throwing it into his garden and he would backed onto the train, and he just couldn't be bothered to carry it to the next station.
That's amazing. What a guy.
What a guy, I know. Here's a picture of him in this era.
Ooh, like a fine wine.
Mm.
So he's... God, he doesn't look like he's in that much, like, as much war as he had.
No.
He just looks so... calm. He's at his desk. He's got a nice suit on. God, you wouldn't think, you know, if you met him at this age, you would never think that he had gone and killed Nazis with a sword and a bow and arrow and bagpipes. You just never know, do you? Like, you know, looking at
any
him,
of us could have done that.
Yeah, like looking at him, it's just like,
that's a British stiff upper lip for you.
It is, yeah. Unassuming. Mm. God.
So we'll have a little bit of a chat about Jack and his warfare in a moment, but just to wrap up Jack's story, mm-hmm. Jack died peacefully in 1996, but he left his mark on modern war forever as the only man to take a sword into battle as his primary weapon in World War II. Some have suggested the name Fighting Jack Churchill, but that doesn't seem quite right. He's mad, all right, and thank God he was on our side. So, Linz, that's the story of Mad Jack Churchill. Firstly, what are your impressions of this gentleman?
You know what? He was a man that played by his own rules. He had his own strategies. But he didn't just look out for himself. He saved everyone. He took prisoners. He was a very sportsmanlike.
Mm-hmm. He's not mad in the traditional sense of the word, not in the box of frogs sense of the word.
No.
More in the courageous sense of the word.
I mean, he probably was mad, running on the beach with his long sword and playing his bagpipes at 3 a.m. while everyone's trying to get some rest. But yeah, like you said, I'm glad he was on our side. It just feels like such a British kind of folk hero story. Mm. It really does. Like, just a guy with his own choice of weapons, going to the beat of his own bagpipe. No, I love this story. It's amazing.
Have you ever heard of this before?
I hadn't. I'm sure I read something about someone using a bow and arrow in World War II. Mm. I'm sure there was, you know, others kind of utilizing whatever they had now and again. But I've not heard of Mad Jack.
To be honest, in theory,
the bow and arrow was pretty good.
It's quieter than any gun, even with the silencer could be.
Uh-huh.
It's relatively light. You can reuse the ammunition. But as we've said, that it's not as... You've got to be a damn good shot for it.
I was about to say, if you're good with it, what a skill.
Mm.
What a skill. I've seen like pros who can like shoot an arrow around a corner. So if he really was that good, it's like... Imagine though, like there's no warning sign of that. You could be standing next to a guy and you'd hear like, and then mm-hmm. thud.
Yeah.
Like, it's kind of scary. It's a very old school. He was old school, wasn't he? Like, what year was he born?
He was born in 1906.
06. Yeah. He sounds like a man of his time. Probably a bit older than his years.
he sounds like, to me... You know those people that you meet in life that feel a generation removed from where they would have
yes,
thrived?
Yes, exactly.
It seems like, you know, in World War I, if you'd carried a sword, it would have been pretty much par for the course, especially in the early days. The longbow, maybe not so much, but, you know, I mean, the pipes in themselves are not unusual. I mean, even today, certain regiments of the British Army have bagpipers, but they also...
Yeah, but they're not showing up on the battlefield just like blowing out a tune.
No, but, you know.
But it obviously hyped him up. Like, I wonder if he had his tipple of wine and got his bagpipes out and was like, you know, his Dutch courage and then just sort of went for it. But whatever that was, it worked. Like, people were probably like, the fuck is this guy? Well, would have thrown me off.
There were descriptions of, especially in the you know, Dunkirk, of, you know, there's written... entries which I read in research of this episode of like soldiers writing diaries after the fact saying, you know, the most bolstering sight was seeing Mad Jack Churchill emerge from the smoke with bagpipes over one arm and an injured soldier over the other, you know, screaming and shouting and swearing about having to retreat and brandishing his sword.
He was just a legend, isn't he?
Yeah.
Imagine that, like the silhouette of him with the bagpipes coming through the smoke. Just absolute legend, honestly. So, is there any movies about him? Or?
There's not any movies about him, but he has been. It was the way I heard about this gentleman was on QI. He was brought up on QI.
Okay.
Which is a very, you know, if any of our listeners don't know what QI is, and just, you know, look it up. It's a great and very informative quiz show. But there's been no sort of biographies on him or anything. But I would love to see a sort of
like a Hacksaw Ridge movie, but with about Mad Jack.
I would like to see, yeah, two movies, both made at the same time, identical. One which is kind of like Die Hard, like over the top action, and the other one being sort of like, you know, what Dewey Cox, the parody movie of Walk Hard.
God, why is this ringing a bell?
You know, like you get you know, there'll be a big movie that comes out and you get a parody movie.
Mm-hmm.
I want a parody movie, but it's not parodying any movie. It's just an exaggerated telling of his life. Because half of these things sound unreal to begin with. So you just see a little bit of movie magic in there.
Yep.
And whew.
It's going to be good.
It is.
We need it. There's so many movies that should be made. There's probably a play. Like you said, everything is a fucking play. And I like criticized you for saying that at the time. But ever since you...
I have no memory of saying this.
You were like, oh, they'll make a fucking play out of anything. But it's true. Like every subject that I've researched for, like after that.
Terrari.
Yeah. Every... I was like, what was that noise? I thought you hurt yourself.
Banged my knee on the table.
Yeah. No, but like every topic that I've researched since then, I've looked, does it have a play? Yes, it always has a play. Loveland Frog has a play.
Is it an iguana or a frog or Mad Jack Churchill? I'm so hungry.
I'm so hungry.
Well, on that bombshell, Linz, have you got any closing comments on our man, Mad Jack Churchill?
Nope, I just want to play the bagpipes, I think, in a threatening manner. Like if I have a grudge with someone, I want to storm in like in a cloud of smoke with my bagpipes playing something really menacing.
Well, thank you very much for listening to this story of Mad Jack Churchill.
Thank you.
And next time it's going to be your story, isn't it?
Yes, yes. Quite a different style of topic, but you know.
No bagpipes?
No bagpipes, no. A lot of other things.
Well, we'll find out in 2 weeks' time when we'll see you again. I'll find out in about 2 minutes' time when we record the next episode.
Yep. On a roll. Maybe we should stretch your legs.
So thank you very much, everybody, and we'll see you next time. Bye.
Bye.